Good morning, Peak City. My name is Austin Matthews.
And mine's Christina Phillips.
And we're so glad that you've joined us online today.
You have actually joined us on a very special Sunday because we are kicking off our brand new series titled From This Day Forward. And let me tell you, you are in for a treat.
That's right. Mm-hmm. So grab y'all's Bibles, get somewhere comfortable, and let's get ready for worship.
Hello, Peak City Church. We're so glad that you've joined us for worship today. Let's stand together. Let's lift our praise to Jesus. Come on. Let's sing together. Let praise be a weapon that silences the enemy. Let praise be the weapon that conquers all anxiety. Let it today.
Church, we can trust him. Let's praise his name together. Yeah. thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Hey, everyone. It's time for the first update of 2021 for the Growing Roots Project. The Growing Roots Project is a 3-year faith-raising project where we as a church family have committed to raise $500,000 to be able to purchase land for a permanent facility here in the Triangle of North Carolina for Peak City Church. And so through this 3-year project, if you'd like to get involved, we'd love to have you join the journey towards a permanent established home here in North Carolina. You can always find out more information about how you can give over at our website, growingrootsproject.com. As of today, if everyone's giving faithfully towards their commitments, we should be at $222,222.08. But because of your faithfulness and how God has continued to show himself faithful, we've currently raised $227,896. Praise God for his faithfulness. Thank you so much for your generosity. And if you'd like to join the journey again, you can check out our website at growingrootsproject.com. I've got a few quick announcements for you today. If it's your first time with us, we'd love for you to fill out an online connect card. You can see it right there in the chat at Church Online, or you can check it out on the homepage of our website at peakcity.church. As always, you can check in on Facebook. There's 2 billion people on Facebook right now, and if you check in at Peak City Church from wherever you are, people in your social networks are going to find out that you're a part of a gospel preaching church. And they may check us out and they may hear the gospel and Jesus might save their souls and transform their life forever. We've seen it happen. And if that wasn't good enough, we're also gonna just give a $2 donation for an organization doing the most good locally or around the world just because you checked in on Facebook. Check in as many times as you want. All those $2 donations are gonna go towards the Salvation Army this month as they're helping to do the most good to feed those and to clothe those in these cold winter months. Speaking of which, this is the final week of our coat drive, and obviously we're at Church Online today because of inclement weather. And because of that, you can bring your coats in throughout the week if you'd like to Peak City HQ. That's located at 1000 Old Raleigh Road. It's in the KB Atkins Dentistry Building. And if you just wanna set up a time before you come, it's as easy as you emailing office@peakcity.church. to let us know. Other than that, you can bring your coats next Sunday if the weather holds up and we're allowed to meet outside. Don't forget, that's February 7th, which is also our Super Bowl Sunday. It's on the screen. You see what I did there? It's pretty slick. We want you to bring canned food, whether it's soup or whatever canned veggies you've got. Maybe you'd stocked up on some stuff from 2020 just in case. Well, let's donate that to the people in need so we can stock the pantry shelves of our local food pantry, the Western Wake Crisis Ministry Center. It will be such a blessing for hungry people in need. So bring those cans of soup on February the 7th. Now, maybe you're interested in being a part of the tech team at Peak City Church through our creative arts ministry. Well, we've got an awesome opportunity that's developing because there's a video team that's coming together. If you want to learn more about videography, running cameras, or how we do what we do on a Sunday morning or for Church Online like you see today, join us. Tonight at HQ at 6 p.m., Pastor John's going to be leading a training. You're more than welcome to come. It'll be offered in person, and I believe he'll be offering via Zoom as well. You just need to contact him to let him know that you're interested. So you can email Pastor John at john.headley@peakcity.church. Hey, I'm so excited to be worshiping with you today. Let's continue to worship Jesus.
Hey, I'm Mitch Cartrett. I'm one of the pastors on staff here at Peak City Church. And it's that time in our worship celebration that we get to give back to God through worship. Hey, there are 4 ways that you can give. You can give online by going to peakcity.church/give. Or you can pull out your phone and right there on our app. That's an easy way to give. And you can even text to give as well. Those are all safe and easy and reliable ways. And if you're not comfortable giving digitally that way, then you can also mail in a check to our P.O. box. Hey, we're so thankful for your faithful generosity. So thank you so much for making a difference here at Peak City Church. Hey, we're going to join Pastor Nate at this time for the word and a great message today.
Thank you. Hey, everybody. Welcome to Church Online. My name is Nate. I'm one of the pastors on staff here at Peak City. I am so excited that you're joining us today. Maybe it's your first time with us at Church Online. Hey, if you're with us today for the first time, you can actually just click that link that just popped up in the chat that will let you fill out an online connect card. In fact, we'd just love to hear from you a little bit to be able to give you the information you'd like to have about Peak City and to be able to celebrate that it was your first time with us today. And it's a great time to join us for the first time because we're starting a brand new series of messages called From This Day Forward. And we're talking about marriage and relationships. And look, there is something over the next 3 weeks for absolutely everyone that's listening. If you're a person who is married, this is going to be a series of messages to help you strengthen your marriage. In fact, if you're wanting to get married one day, this is going to be a set of tools that's going to help you. It's going to help you keep your focus on the Lord and look for the right things in your spouse. And not just that, but to be the right kind of spouse that someone's looking for. If your marriage is a wreck and you want to be done with it, I think you're going to receive hope over these next 3 weeks through this series of messages. And maybe you're just like, nah, marriage just isn't for me. I'm just not doing it. You know, I'm gonna do the Jesus thing, or I'm gonna go like all, you know, Apostle Paul in his ministry and just, you know, just not be married. If that's you, hey, look, there are going to be tools that you're going to really receive and glean over the next 3 weeks that are going to help you love married people well, to help point them to Jesus. So no matter where you are on the spectrum, this next 3 weeks is really for you. I'm really excited about this. So let's lean in together. What we're going to do is we're going to pray, and then we're going to jump into the Word. As always, if you'd like to check out past messages from Peak City Church, you can head over to our website at peakcity.church/messages. So let's pray together. God, I pray that you would open our hearts, help us to be humble enough to know that we don't have it all together, that great marriages and great relationships, they take work, and really they take a focus that's stayed on you more than anything. So humbly, God, we come before you now and we ask for your help. We ask you to help us to love you well, to love our spouses well, to love people well, and to really seek out to be the man and the woman that you've called us to be, so that one day we're going to marry a man or a woman that you've called us to be with. Help us, Lord, not to look to the past and the failures and the mistakes that we've made in the past to define us, but rather with your power and strength working in and through us, and with you setting our direction, that we'd live to honor you in our most important earthly relationships from this day forward. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, look, when it comes to marriage, most people have a lot of hopes and dreams when it comes to what that's going to look like. Like you think about it, if you want to be married one day, and those of you that are, you remember doing this before you got married, like, especially you ladies out there, you know, I think you had it all planned out. Like you knew the kind of dress you wanted to wear, exactly what you wanted your wedding to be like, you know, the car that you were going to drive away in, or, you know, how ornate and all sophisticated it was going to be, or the lack thereof. Like, and you had already thought about how many kids you want to have. You probably already named them and picked their genders out. You're like, I'm going to have 3 girls and 2 boys. Praise God for your faith, you know. And you had looked at what marriage was going to look like your husband was just going to be, you know, the kind of husband that before you can even get the word something smells out of your mouth, he's already jumped up out of bed and grabbed the diaper and grabbed the baby powder and said, honey, you just stay there and watch this episode of The Blacklist. Daddy's going to go take care of it. Like you had it all planned out in your mind as to what you wanted when it came to marriage. And man, you did too. Like you had your hopes and dreams when it came to marriage, and yours were probably a lot more simple, and they center around that thing that you're thinking about right now. For those of you that aren't aware of what I'm talking about, I know there's kids watching, so I'll say it this way. You men out there, you were just pretty much excited about getting to experience the fun part of love twice a day or something like that, right? So how are those hopes and dreams working out? Because the reality is this, we've all come into relationships, or when we actually get to meet that person and start a relationship with the one that we hope to marry one day, we're going to come in with a box of hopes and dreams. And it can look like a lot of things, you know. In our box of hopes and dreams, it could be how many kids we're going to have, or where we're going to live, or what our careers are going to look like. You know, it could be that we're going to have our financial house in order, that we're going to retire a certain way. It could be that we're going to do ministry together or whatever, you know. Whatever those hopes and dreams look like to you, Well, to the person you're in a relationship with, on the other side of this box, it looks a bit different. It doesn't just look like hopes and dreams. To them, it looks a whole lot like expectations. You see, it's very, very different to the other person in the relationship. All this stuff that you had hoped for, it becomes weighty for the person that you're in a relationship with. They feel like there is this standard that they've got to be able to reach. And it can get really ugly really quickly, especially when a spouse does something crazy. Like when a daddy's girl out there says, well, my daddy did it this way. Or the mama's boy out there says, well, my mama did it. That's not even the notes. That's for free. If you've done that to your spouse, stop. If you've thought about doing that to your spouse, don't do that. Let's not light that Molotov cocktail, because that's the sort of thing that's going to end up in the counseling room with me. Just remember, everybody comes into marriage with hopes and dreams, but oftentimes by the other person, it's interpreted as expectations. And it can be hard. Just to go ahead and get this out of the way, is a great marriage possible? Yes, a great marriage is possible. It absolutely is. But if you do it the world's way, and if you try to meet the world's standards for what marriage is or what it looks like or what you should put into it, it's not going to go well. I mean, don't let media and Hollywood and all that stuff be the driving force but behind the way that you view marriage. Because the newest data that's come out, it's promising. In fact, we used to say half the marriages that people enter into will fail. Well, the new data says this now. Like, that was an all-time high. Marriages failing was back in the 1970s, and it slowly started to taper off in the 80s and 90s. And at this point, it's still just under 40% of marriages that don't make it. So 39% of all the marriages out there, you know, they don't survive. And of the 61% that do, a lot of them just aren't happy. They're miserable. They're just sticking it out for the kids, or they have their own reasons, but it's just not the healthy, fulfilling relationship that God actually intended marriage to be. And I want to help us with that. Because if you think about it, if you knew that there was a 40% chance that something important to you was going to go the wrong direction, you'd probably do something about it. So why in the world don't we treat our marriages that way? Like, for instance, if you've invested your money in a retirement account and you knew that week there was a 40% chance that you were going to lose all your money, would you do something about it? You would. If there was a restaurant in town that somebody invited you to go to, but you knew that if you went there was a 40% chance that you were going to get food poisoning, you would not go to that restaurant. Like, you would do something about it. You would say, hey, you know what? Let me make a suggestion to where maybe we go to a restaurant where the health department doesn't give them an F- grade. Where we don't have to pull the boards off the front door that says condemned to be able to get inside and get a taco or something like that. Yeah, you don't want to do that, you know? We want to make sure that we understand that there is something that we can do to be able to strengthen our marriage. And when we live in a climate where there's 40% that don't make it, God steps in to show us that His plan looks a lot different than the world's plan and can help us to fail-proof our marriage. You think about it this way. I think it's crazy that, a good example. I used to be a waiter back when I was in my early 20s. You know, I waited tables at an Italian restaurant. And to become a waiter in that restaurant, I had to go through a week of training, like watching videos, looking about food safety standards and how that particular restaurant was going to operate and all that stuff. That was just to be able to bring food to people's table. And yet, you know, when it comes to marriage, all you got to do is go to the Register of Deeds and give them $60 and they'll give you a marriage license. And you can go stand before a justice of the peace somewhere and they'll marry you. That it's just that simple. Something that important and that life-changing, and yet there's no guardrails for people. And that's what happens when you go about marriage in a way that's not God's design. Like, you have to understand that we want to do this God's way. So if the next 3 weeks help us to do that, then that's a massive win for all of us. Because I need you to understand right now, marriage is a spiritual union. It is not this consumer, legal agreement. There's so much more to it. Marriage is a covenant with God. And so I want us to do it God's way. I want you to be able to enter into a spiritual union. Like, if you're thinking about getting married, I want you to be able to come to a pastor and have them walk you through what marriage looks like, and to be able to marry you in a way that is God-honoring. So I want to encourage you to do that. No matter where you are, I want you to think that way. Tim Keller said this. He said, a consumer relationship says, you adjust to me or I'm out of here. But a covenant relationship says, I adjust to you because I've made a promise. And I think a lot of us have gotten a consumer mindset when it comes to marriage, where we say, it's got to be my way. My needs aren't being met. You know, this isn't going the way that I had hoped, and because it's not what I want, I'm out. But God has a different plan for our marriages, one that can bring hope not just into your heart, but into the heart of your spouse, and you can actually see these relationships become strengthened and transformed to look completely different than they do possibly now if they are struggling. So, the Bible has a lot to say about marriage. I mean, if you think about this, the way that the Scripture tells us really when it comes to marriage is that marriage is God's idea all along. Genesis 2:24, a man would leave his father and mother and he should cling to his wife and the two would become one, right? In the Ten Commandments, in Deuteronomy chapter 5, God talks about marriage to protect it. He calls divorce cruel in Malachi chapter 2, verse 16. In fact, he says, it's like you're doing something violent, men, to your wife by doing this, because you're subjecting them to some kind of awful thing when you're the one that's responsible for protecting them. See, God doesn't want divorce to be an option for us. And you're watching today, and some of you I know have been divorced in the past, and I'm not throwing stones at you. What I'm saying is, let's get a heart and a focus that says, I can't do anything about what's happened in the past, but from this day forward, we're gonna take that off the table. 1 Corinthians 7:5, it makes it very clear that Satan wants your marriage to be destroyed. In fact, God wants your marriage to succeed. Remember what he said. He said, what God's joined together, let no one tear apart. That's Matthew chapter 19. 1 Peter 3:7 tells us that God holds us accountable for our marriages. In other words, we're gonna put the work in. God holds us personally responsible for making sure we're working towards having a healthy marriage. The book of Hebrews chapter 13, verse 4, it tells us that marriage is a gift that helps us to remain pure before God. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 22 through 33, God actually uses marriage to model His love for the world. In fact, there's an entire book on love and marriage in the Old Testament called Song of Solomon, and we did a whole series of messages walking through Song of Solomon last year. You can check that out at our website. So all that said, as we look through the Scripture, that's just some of the things that God has to say about marriage. Why so many things? It's because God takes marriage seriously. That's why when we take our vows, that they're serious vows. And most marriage vows say something like, you know, for me, example, I Nate, take you, Angie, to be my wife, to have and to hold in sickness and health, for better, for worse, forsaking all others, being faithful to you as long as we both shall live. You know, you do all those things. And then they include this line in there that you're going to do all this from this day forward in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We take these serious vows because marriage is a serious thing. It is a covenant that we're taking, committing ourselves one to another, and we're doing that before God. And so, in other words, we're not just making the commitment to the person that's standing across the altar from us. We're making it to the God that created us. And so when someone wants to step out of the marriage, when you want to break faith with the marriage, you're breaking faith in a lot of ways with God as you made that commitment to this other person. So God takes this very, very seriously. So having said all of that, I love diesel trucks. That doesn't make a lot of sense when you talk about marriage. I own a diesel truck and I found out that I really like them after I came to own one. The reason I bought one was because our church is a set up tear down church and we pack all of our equipment into these very large trailers. The smallest one that we own is 24 feet long, an enclosed trailer. And I was towing that with my Toyota Sequoia for a while, and I learned really quickly that that was not going to cut it. I needed something with more pulling power, and so I got a older truck that had a diesel engine in it. And the truck that I bought was a Ford, and to make this story short, it was the first year that they had put these technologies into these diesel engines to make them cleaner burning. Because whether you're a car person or not, you know that when it comes to a diesel vehicle, a diesel truck, one of the most common things you see come out of the tailpipe is what? It's a bunch of soot, right? Like black soot just blowing out of the tailpipe. Well, to keep the air cleaner, there were new standards that came out, and they had to put new technology in to burn off some of that soot. Well, in my truck in particular, and that new system they had put in, this truck, this engine had all this cool new technology in it, and it was supposed to be this great engine, but this one small part that was responsible for helping to burn off all of that soot that was coming out of the tailpipe, that this one small part in this engine failed. And because this one small part failed, it caused the engine to get hotter and hotter and hotter and hotter until eventually it would blow up. The head gaskets would blow, your engine would just it would just grenade on you. In fact, it's the engine that I have in my truck is called a 6.0 liter. The nickname for the engine became the 6-point blow just because of this one small issue. Well, this company out west decided to take a hard look at this fleet of Ford trucks with this engine that was just causing a nightmare for consumers and for that Ford Motor Company. They pulled it apart and they said, okay, we've got a fix for this one small part and these four other areas that we see that need some attention too. But if you do these five fixes, these five smaller parts to this huge, powerful diesel engine, it's going to turn this piece of junk engine into something that people are going to love. It's going to be dependable, powerful, reliable. And they basically said it's going to turn your truck into a 500,000-mile truck. It's going to give you a 500,000-mile engine, which is really, really good. So in the same way that that process became known, the company that did that was Bulletproof Diesel, and that process to those trucks became known as bulletproofing. Well, I want to give us five steps to help us bulletproof our marriage. I think the best way to say it is that process that they developed out west for that truck really helped to fail-proof that engine. Well, I want to give us some simple steps over the next 3 weeks that are going to help us to fail-proof our marriages. So I'm going to ask us to make a commitment. We're going to make a commitment each week that we get together over the next 3 weeks. And it's going to help us to be able to fail-proof our marriages. All right, so how do we do it? It's going to take commitment. The first commitment that we're going to make is this. We're committed to seeking God. We are committed to seeking God. Now, at Peak City Church, this is not a strange thing to us. One of our core values is that Jesus is the center. He's the center of our church, and He is the center of each and every one of our individual lives. He comes first, He gets our best, and He is our highest priority. But here's the problem. Most people that are seeking a spouse, they're not doing it to make God happy. They're not doing it to please the God that's at the center of our lives. They're doing it to make themselves happy. They're seeking a spouse that's just going to make them feel the way they want to feel. Like that really just kind of checks all the boxes and all the stuff that they aren't, they're expecting their spouse to be. And they get into this whole Jerry Maguire thing. Now, for you kids that don't know who Jerry Maguire is, I'm so glad that everyone that's under the age of 30 is watching today. Thank you for joining us. It's a movie in the olden days, back in the 90s, and it had this one quote that everybody thinks about if they've seen the movie. It's this idea of two people, when they fall in love, they say, "You complete me." Wow. See, we're taking our focus off of the one that can complete us, and we're putting that mantle on somebody else, and it's a weight and a responsibility that they never deserve to have, and it's unfair for us to put that kind of expectation on that person. So here's what I want to say to you today. God has to come first in your life. And the series that we're doing right now is based off a book that was written by Pastor Craig Groeschel called From This Day Forward. And this is the way that he says this. He says, for a marriage to be successful, to be able to fail-proof your marriage, God has to be your one, and your spouse has to be your two. Think about it. Matthew chapter 22 says this. And he said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment." Nowhere in the scripture there does it say that you shall love your spouse with all your heart, mind, soul, all of that. No, it says God first, and then the spiritual and scriptural directive says that our spouse comes next. So we need to make sure that God is our one and our spouse is our number two. Now, all the unmarried people, all right, out there, catch this. I want you to be able to focus in on this. If you're looking for a spouse, here's your commitment. It's that you're going to seek the one while preparing for your two. I'm going to seek the one while preparing for my two. Like, if you want a blessed marriage, like if you want to serve God together, if you want to be successful at raising kids, or if you want to keep your financial house in order, or be generous people, like if you want to make an eternal difference with your life, you've got to keep the order correct. Seek the one with your two. In other words, don't seek all those good things I just listed. You seek God first. And this is what he says will happen. Matthew 6:33. It says, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then all that other stuff, all that other good stuff, all that other God-honoring stuff, all of those God-honoring hopes and dreams will be added unto you. But you got to get the order right. In his book, Pastor Craig told a story about a girl who was saving herself for marriage. And all through high school, she was so passionate for God and pursuing her relationship with him. And then she got to college and she kind of looked around and said, wow, the pickings are slim here for some godly guys here at college. And so slowly but surely, she started to let her standards drop. And her moral compass that was set by the Holy Spirit leading her life started to erode because she stopped spending time with God. And she just started allowing herself to get out and party more. And so she started partying regularly. Then she started sleeping around. And then around about the end of her college days there, in that senior year of school, she meets the one. Like, she just saw him and she knew it. She was like, this is the one. You know, he was about 6'2", sandy blonde hair, salt and pepper beard, a little bit husky, you know. No, I'm just kidding. I'm kidding. This is definitely not a story about Miss Angie. I was a lot skinnier back in the day, and I didn't have any gray in my beard. No, this girl, she met the man of her dreams. This guy just hung the moon for her. And she goes home on break, and she's telling her mom all about this guy. And she says, oh, he's this, he's that, he's wonderful. He's just the kind of guy that I had prayed for all those years and I was looking for. And her mom looks back at her daughter and says, oh, honey, I'm so sorry. And she's like, what do you mean? She's like, well, let's face it, you're not the kind of girl that a godly man is looking for. Ouch. You can say that at home. Ouch. That hurt me just to say it. And mom just gave her daughter a real tough dose of reality. But here's the truth that I want to make sure that we understand, that like attracts like. Like in our last series that we just went through, the All In series, we asked the question. We said, you know, who do we want to become? And then we started asking ourselves the questions, hey, what steps do we need to take to become that? What are some small commitments that we can make today that are going to drive us towards becoming the person that God wants us to be? Well, I would ask you the question, what kind of person do you want to marry? You need to become that kind of person. Like, you need to work towards becoming the godly man or the godly woman that God wants you to be if you're seeking out that kind of spouse in your life. Why? Because like attracts like. Now, for you married people out there, remember, if you're already married, you got to always keep that commitment that I'll always seek the one with my two. And you got to keep the order right. Now, You can't make your spouse the one. If they sit in the place that God is supposed to sit in, like we said earlier, you're putting a crushing weight and an expectation on their lives that they're never going to be able to live up to. They are not your Jesus, and they are people, and they will fail you. They'll make mistakes. And the problem is when that happens, then our attitude and our heart towards them completely changes, and it's completely unfair to our spouse. Look, and it's not even that we just don't get the number one spot right and other mistakes happen. A lot of times when we set God in the first place in our heart, in our marriage, if we're not careful, we'll put our kids in the number two position. And this is not a biblical plan for your marriage. Like, God never said, hey, love me with all your heart. When you get married, your heart's divided. You're going to love me, but you're also going to love your spouse. And your spouse is going to be second most important in your life. But then you have kids, and they replace your spouse on that love meter. No, that's not the case. If you make your kids the second most important love relationship in your life, all of a sudden you're going to do so much to degrade and to destroy your marriage relationship, because your marriage is no longer the priority that God has called it to be. Get the order right. Making your spouse the first place in your heart or the fifth place in your heart, that is not going to work. You're asking them to do something that they're not capable of doing. What happens then when we get the order wrong? Well, when we get the order wrong, let's say we make them the number one place in our life, then what we've done is we've idolized our spouse. We've put them in the God seat in our life. And when our idols fail us, what do? We go from loving them and thinking that they hang the moon. Our attitude goes from, oh, wow, he's just so caring. He's just so laid back. You know, I just have peace whenever I'm around him. And then he lets you down, and all of a sudden your attitude changes completely too. He's so lazy. He won't get up off the couch. It's like he doesn't even care. Nothing really fazes him. I tell him I'm really upset about something, and he's just like, it's going to be okay. Really? You see, what you idolize, eventually you're going to demonize, because idols will fail you. You know, in the same way, you might say, wow, she's just so organized and so driven. She makes me a better, I just love her so much. She makes me a better me. That's what she does. And then 6, 7, 8 months down the road into your marriage, all of a sudden, all those things that you thought were so wonderful, they become terrible. And you say, ah, she's constantly nagging me and nitpicking me and making me clean up after myself. Why? Because those that idolize, so those that put somebody in the God seat in their life that don't belong in the God seat, they demonize. So we've got to seek God. We've got to seek the one with our two. So how do we seek God? Well, the psalmist said this in Psalm chapter 10, in the pride of his face, the wicked does not seek him. All of his thoughts are, there is no God. Psalm chapter 10, verse 6, he says in his heart, I shall not be moved. Throughout all generations, I shall not meet adversity. See, that's about as unwise as it gets, when the pride of your heart says, there is no God and I can do it on my own, because I'm going to go ahead and let you know, no, you can't. That's a weight that's too great for you to bear. To seek God, we have to acknowledge that He is there and He is present and He is right there in the midst of the relationship, and He wants us to draw closer to Him. And we need to look at it as if it was a triangle, where God is at the top and each spouse is at the bottom corners of that triangle. And the closer we get to God, the closer we're going to get in our relationship with our spouse. 1 Chronicles chapter 28, verse 9. Know the God of your father and serve him with a whole heart and a willing mind. For the Lord searches all hearts and understands every plan and thought. And if you seek Him, He will be found by you. How do we seek God? First of all, we seek Him with our whole heart. I remember when I was recently trying to buy my wife a new used car, because she was driving a now 18-year-old SUV that was starting to fall apart. And I'm like, man, I can do better than this for my bride. And I want her to be safe on the road. And when she's carrying my kids around, I want them to have that safety too. So I was looking for something that was about 5 years old. And if you know me, I want to get the best price I can get, but I'm not cheap, I'm frugal. So I'm trying to get the best quality I can get for the best price. And that is hard. That's hard to do. That takes a lot of seeking and looking. And I can't tell you how many times I found a vehicle for her that was exactly what she wanted. And I got in the car and I was on my way to go get it, and it got sold out from under me. And I was looking at vehicles that were 2, 3, 4 states away, until I found one finally for her down in Georgia, in Atlanta, that the dealership agreed to hold it for me until I drove down to be able to purchase it. And now she's a happy girl. But it took me seeking and looking and trying to find the best that I could possibly find. You know, like, if, and it doesn't just, you know, fall in line with something that's a major purchase like that. Like, if you love food and you're looking for good pizza, you're going to seek it, aren't you? And you're going to enjoy every, you know, 2,000 calorie pizza dinner you have until you find that right pizza. It's worth looking for you. If you lose your car keys, you're going to seek them. The bottom line is this: the more important it is, the harder you're going to search. And when it comes to seeking God, when it comes to seeking the one with your two, This is as important as it gets, and we need to seek hard after God. Now, there's all kinds of practical ways that we can seek God together in our marriage relationships, and we can be seeking God together in our dating relationships as we head into marriage. I mean, and it's as simple as reading God's Word together, attending church together, getting in a city group together so you're studying the Bible and having fellowship with other believers. By the way, there's a brand new city group that's kicking off in Sanford. And if you're in the Sanford area, you're somewhere in Lee County or something like that, and you would like more information on that group, then why don't you email us at office@peakcity.church, and we'll send you more information about the Sanford group. Or you can just head over to our website, and you can click yourself right there at peakcity.church/citygroups. We'd love for you to get connected. All kinds of ways that you can, with that significant other, engage in seeking God together. You can do life with God together. And remember, we talked in our last series about a keystone habit. We talked about one habit that affects positive momentum in everything we do in our life, or one habit that makes everything go south, like one destructive negative thing that just causes everything to go in a negative direction. So when it comes to a positive keystone habit, it's no surprise for me that mine is that I start every day with prayer. In fact, this is how it's changed my life. It's affected me so much that Angie and I, we started praying regularly together before we got married. So that's why I say, dating people, start praying with the person you're dating right now. And if they refuse to do that, friends, that's a big old red flag. And I give you permission to break it off. If that's the kind of person that you're dating that doesn't want to seek God, know it right now that it's not likely to change when you enter into a marriage relationship. And there's a lot of people that have gone through the pain of divorce that would be amen in me right now, because they don't want you to go through that kind of pain either. Remember the keystone habit. For me, prayer, it's transformed everything in my life. I pray with my wife regularly. I pray with my kids before they go off to school. I pray with them every night. We do devotions together in a Bible story. 2 times a year as a church, obviously we go through seasons of prayer and fasting, focused prayer. It's such a critical aspect of my life, and it's changed everything. It's a great keystone habit, so let it be no surprise that I would say the one thing that we could focus on today that will make the biggest, most drastic impact in your marriage is that you pray together daily. Now, for you unmarried people, just know this. Prayer isn't some light thing where your mind's kind of drifting off into space. Like, when you really are engaging the God of heaven that created you with your potential spouse, you're going to find it's one of the most intimate things that you can do. You really get to know somebody's heart of hearts when they're coming before the Lord and they're bearing that heart to Him with you in prayer. Hey, married people, you want more intimacy in your marriage? Well, develop a healthy prayer life. You're going to see some things come out, and it's going to develop such a trust in one another that you're going to start looking to each other as intercessors and prayer warriors for one another, because prayer is powerful. And remember, if you're not married and they refuse to do this with you, you 100% have my permission. Let them go. Just be done with it. It's over. Send them a text right now and be like, hey, I blame my pastor. I'm more than happy to take that email from somebody that's upset that you went ahead and said, hey, it's time for you to go to the curb. I'm seeking out a godly person for me to spend the rest of my life with from this day forward. Remember what the Bible says about prayer and its power. 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven. I will forgive their sin. I will heal their land. Do you want your marriage to be healed? Turn to God together. Seek the one with your two. Spend time together seeking God. So you say, well, how do I do it? How? Because, you know, this is, and I understand that this is complicated for some people. Maybe you're married to a non-believer. What I would say to you, if you're in that situation, commit to pray for them. And then, you know, if they're the kind of person that just won't let you pray for them, send them a text message through the day. Hey, I know you got a meeting today, praying for you. Or just praying that you have a great day at work. You know, or hey, I was just thanking God for you today. You'll never understand how much you mean to me. Start telling them that you're praying for them. And then start maybe praying before you guys eat your meals together. And then if you get that in a regular habit of thanking God for your food, then why don't you start asking around the table, hey, is there something that we can pray together about today? Something you want me to pray for you? And maybe it'll develop into the point, just maybe, where that unbelieving spouse will let you actually take them by the hands and pray for them. If you're married and this has not been a practice of your marriage, you got to do it. Look, I'm going to make it easy for you. The easiest way to get over the awkwardness of praying with somebody is by praying with somebody. Anytime you do something new, you're rarely great at it when you start, right? When you took that language class in high school, that first semester of whatever language you took, your accent was hilarious. If you took Spanish, you probably said, "Yo soy un gringo, uno hablar español." And you sounded like you were from Long Beach trying to speak Spanish. Didn't matter. You were trying. You were doing something new, and you got better at it over time. Prayer works the same way. To get past the awkwardness, you've got to do it. And if you get in a rhythm of doing it, guess what? It's really hard to pray with somebody that you're mad at. It's going to start improving the temperature of your relationships. It's really hard to divorce someone that you're committed to praying with every day. Why? Because you're praying through issues and struggles that you have together, and you're allowing the God of heaven, who has the power to actually do something about it, to do something about it. If you pray with your spouse, it's really difficult to have an affair with somebody else when you're seeking God with the one that God has given you. The secret to a long-lasting marriage is that they are rooted and grounded in prayer. That you live out the words of Proverbs 3, 5 through 6, when you trust in the Lord with all of your heart, and you lean not on your own understanding, and in all of your ways you acknowledge Him, and you let Him make your path straight. You let Him direct your path. Don't you want that for your marriage? Prayer is so vitally important. You know, there was a research group called the Family Life Research Group, and they surveyed thousands of Christian couples, and what they discovered was sad, but not all that surprising. It was that fewer than 8% of thousands of Christian couples that they surveyed pray together regularly. And this is why it's so critically important that you do. Because we're talking about fail-proofing our marriages. And if we get this one right, it's going to be the keystone habit that affects all the other ones we're going to talk about for the next 2 weeks ahead. Fewer than 8% of thousands of Christian couples pray together regularly. But of those that did, fewer than 1% divorce. Prayer is powerful. Prayer needs to be a priority for you in the relationship that you're in your marriage relationship, in your dating relationship. Maybe you haven't done this before, but today you're saying, we're doing it from this day forward. So why don't we just take a moment to pray right now? Why don't you grab the hand of your two while we seek the one? And if you're by yourself, you can just clasp both of your hands together. That'll be just fine too. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you for the gift that we have of marriage. It's a blessing. Lord, help us to never get our priorities out of order. Lord, I pray that in our marriage relationships and in our daily life, that you come first, Lord Jesus, above all things. And that our spouse would come second. And that we wouldn't move them down the priority chain any further than that number two place in our life. But we know that if our heart stays fixed on you, and that we prioritize our marriage like you've called us to prioritize it, that we're going to love better, that we're going to serve better, that not only are we going to find that you've given us the spouse that we dreamed about, but you're making us into the spouse that they dream about. God, I thank you that the closer we get to you, the closer and healthier our marriage relationships will get. And so we're committing to do this your way. Lord, I pray for everybody that's taking a commitment right now to pray together daily in their marriage relationships, in their dating relationships. I pray that those that are making that commitment, even now, that they would just simply say to you, God, I'm doing this from this day forward. Why? Lord Jesus, because you come first. You get my best. You're my highest priority. And I want all of those things to be true in my most important earthly relationship as well. Maybe you're praying with us right now, and wherever you are, you've never taken the most important step you can take in your life. You've never made the most important relationship decision that you could ever make, and that's to ask Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, to surrender your heart and life completely to Him, to allow Him to make you a brand new person. And you know that, and you're ready to make that commitment right now. Well, if that's you, and you're ready to take that step, you can look up at your screen right now and just click that button at Church Online that says, I surrender my life to Jesus. I raise my hand. That's not going to be flashed up on the screen for everybody to see. In fact, when you click that button, that privately just sends us at the church a message that somebody's making a decision to follow Jesus. And we can celebrate that with you. If you're ready to make that decision, maybe you're not at Church Online, maybe you're watching this broadcast at another time, no matter who you are, everyone that's ready to make a decision to make Jesus the Lord of their life, why don't you simply just either click that button or text the word yes to the number you see on your screen right now, 919-289-9278. And we're going to follow up, and we just want to encourage you and send you what your next steps look like in this incredible decision you're making to follow Jesus. And if you're ready to take that step right now, why don't you pray a simple prayer like this with me? Remember, you're talking to the one. You're talking to God when you make this commitment. And you can make that real in your heart, but why don't you pray something like this? Lord Jesus, I surrender my life to you. It's all yours. I ask you to forgive me of my sins and make me brand new. I believe that you can do that because I believe that you died on the cross for me and you made your life a payment for all of the sin and the wrong in my life. And then 3 days later, you rose again from the dead and you defeated death and hell, the grave. You defeated all of that. And because you rose again to life, you can raise me to life again, Jesus. And I'm asking you to do that. Raise me to life. Put a new spirit in me. Make me brand new. Thank you for making me clean. Thank you for making me new. I'm turning away from my old life of sin, and I'm going to live for you. Come and live your life through me. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Hey, if you made a decision to follow Jesus today, we are so excited for you. It is the greatest single decision you'll ever make with your life. And now you're a part of the family of God. And you need a good church family. You need to be in a Bible teaching church. So wherever you're watching this from, I would encourage you, reach out to us. No matter where in the world you are, we'll see if we can help you get connected with a Bible teaching church. Like, we love that you're engaging with Peak City, but we want you to engage with the body of Christ where you live as well. So if you're not in the Triangle area, why don't you treat Peak City Church more like a vitamin that's just kind of helping you along in your spiritual journey, but you need fellowship with the body of Christ. We want to help you with that. We want to help you take your next steps. Email us if you'd like to, office@peakcity.church, or like we said earlier, just text the word yes to 919-289-9278, and we'll follow up with next steps for you. For the rest of you that are around here, we absolutely are so excited to have you engaging with us as well as a part of our church family. Join us next week as we continue this journey to honor God with our relationships from this day forward.
Man, what a great start to our brand new series. I hope that you guys enjoyed that just as much as we did. And if you want to rewatch that message or check out any of our past messages, head over to our website, peakcity.church/messages, and you can check out any of our previous ones there.
And if y'all would like to support the mission and the vision of Peak City Church, you can head on over to peakcity.church/give. Thank you so much for joining us this week. We'll see y'all next week.
Bye.